Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we come before you. Lord, we're just so grateful for the opportunity, for the honor that we have to come into the house of God. As your word says, I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. Father, we thank you that we don't come into this place for tradition, to fill a ritual, Lord, to hear from a man, from the old or from the young. But Lord, we come to hear from you. We fully acknowledge that here at the Rock, it's Jesus that's the senior leader. And Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, would be our counselor. Lord, I pray that you would take the words that I'm speaking, but Lord, I pray that they would be your words, your heart, Lord, that we would hear your word tonight, Lord, for the equipping, that you would lead us and direct us and guide us to be who you've called us to be. And Lord, we thank you that you have blessed us here. Lord, we're so blessed at this church. We thank you for all that you've done for us. And Lord, we don't ask these blessings just upon ourselves. Lord, we ask that you would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and truly around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't ever think of ourselves as better or different, but Lord, we are co-laborers, members of the same body working together to build your kingdom. So Lord, with that, bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and our Adventist and Messianic Jewish brothers and sisters. Lord, we thank you that you bless all the churches belonging to various denominations such as the Baptists and Methodists and Lutherans, Episcopalians. Lord, we thank you for the Calvary chapels around the area. Lord, we ask that you bless churches like Harvest in the Grove and Sandals. Lord, thank you for Water of Life. Bless Ecclesia, Emmanuel Baptist, Victory, Trinity, Lord, New Creation, all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world. Lord, we thank you that we are brothers and sisters in the body of Christ working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So to you be the praise, to you be the glory, to you be the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, I got a fun little message. I was doing some studying this week in my own devotional time, and I was reading a really neat story. And as I was reading the story, I was just kind of skimming through the chapters of the Bible, and I went to the previous chapter, and I saw something amazing, and then I went to the previous chapter, and I saw something amazing, and I really tied it all together. The Lord just spoke to me, and it was really kind of something in my own life that I was kind of like going through and experiencing in my own life, and I've gone through it before a couple of times. And how many know you can go through something, learn all the lessons to learn in that experience, and then like a day later, forget it and start all over again? You know what I'm talking about? Am I the only one in the place today? Hallelujah, I'm not alone. I was a little worried about that one. Today I want to talk to you about preparing for God's promises. Preparing for God's promises. You know, there's all sorts of different promises in the Bible, all sorts of different things that the Word of God speak to us. And you know, as a matter of fact, in our own devotional time, in our own time speaking with God and hearing from God, there are things that individually and personally God speaks to us about our lives. And as I was studying and I was thinking about this, you know, there's a lot of things that we've got to understand in the Word of God, based out of the Word of God, so that we can be equipped to receive and to live a blessed life in God's promises. You want to live a blessed life? Yes, yes you do. Anybody says no, we'll slap you. All right. You know, and I was thinking about that, and preparing for God's promises, there's some things that we need to understand out of the Word of God. And as we was looking at these stories, I want to talk about that. But I'll start it by saying it this, like, you know, there's a lot of times there's things that we want. You know what I'm talking about? Man, I want. I remember there was a time, it was about 2 years ago. I've talked about it often. It was a significant change for me. About 2 years ago, you know, I saw a picture of myself after I had married a great couple here in the church, and they posted a picture on Facebook of me and them, and I thought, that was when I realized, like, wow, you know, I swelled. I don't know, I must have got stung by a bee or something happened to me. And I just realized, you know, I was an active person, and I let something get beyond me. And I realized that there were some things that I needed to do. And I wanted a change of my life. I wanted to lose a little bit of weight. I wanted to get back down to, you know, like they would say, like my fighting weight. Haven't got there yet, but that's okay. Amen. Still want it. But I realized something. You know, you can want something all you want. And you can want it. You can have the utmost desire for it. You can just hope and think and consume your life about your wants. But wanting will only take you so far. You know what I'm talking about? And it wasn't until I made a decision in my life to go beyond wanting, to do something about my wants, to say, okay, I'm going to have to start making hard decisions. Hard decisions like no more cookies right before I go to bed. You know, like not just, well, okay, maybe one cookie. I had to just make the hard decision, like none at all. And until I made those decisions, nothing was happening. And so often in life, that's how we go about it. You know, Pastor Joel sent this meme. You know what memes are? Those little like funny pictures when they put words on them, right? There was this meme that was going around on social media, and I think you guys have that picture? This was a funny picture, and Pastor Joel sent it to me. And it's funny, it's the same guy, and Robert wants to lose weight. So Robert, his before picture and his after picture. And in 2 weeks, the only thing Robert lost was his glasses. You know, wants will only take you so far. You have to do something about what you get, what the Word of God speaks to you. There's something that you and I have to do. It's called action, right? We've got to do something with what God says about His promises, about His Word. And so, you know, maybe you're in this place today, and maybe like for me, you have a goal or you have a want or you have a desire. Maybe it is something like me where it was the losing of the weight or getting back into shape. Or maybe you're in that place where, you know, you want that promotion at the job. Or maybe you want that new job. Or maybe you want that financial breakthrough. You know, you feel like God spoke to me and I feel like, you know, God's taking me on this journey and I'm just waiting. I'm wanting for this to happen. But you kind of sit back and you say, when is it gonna happen? Anybody ever had to wait on the promises of God? Man, I sure have. You begin to realize that there are some things out of the Word of God that we must learn and apply. And I'm the kind of person that I like to understand about things and then learn how to apply them. You know what I mean? Like, it's great to know how to do things, but sometimes I just want to know why things are the way they are. Anybody else like that? So today I thought what we would do is look at the Word of God and what it talks about His promises and preparing for His promises. So if you've got your Bibles, we're going to go to two scriptures today, or two sections of scriptures. We're going to end up in 2 Kings in the 3rd chapter, but we're going to start in Matthew, the 25th chapter. So if you have a little ribbon, you can drop it in 2 Kings, the 3rd chapter. But go with me now to Matthew in the 25th chapter. In Matthew in the 25th chapter, here we have a parable. Jesus is giving a story. Jesus was an amazing teacher in that He knew how to connect to the people through stories. And so He gives these illustrated sermons or these stories. And here is a very well-known sermon or a very well-known story of the parable of the 10 virgins. And we oftentimes equate this to the salvation message. This is an illustration of salvation and how people will hear it or they won't. But let's just look at what Jesus says in the first 10 chapters here of Matthew, the 25th, or 10 verses here of Matthew, the 25th chapter. Matthew chapter 25, verse number 1, He says, "And then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise, 5 of them were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them." We can say it like this: they were unprepared for the night, okay? "But those who were wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps." They brought a spare, or they brought extra reserves. "But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and they slept. And at midnight a cry was heard, 'Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him.' And then all those virgins arose and they trimmed their lamps and they got them all ready to go. And the foolish ones said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil for our lamps. Our lamps are going out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'No, lest there should not be enough for us and you, but rather go to those who sell and buy oil for yourselves.' And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding, and the door was shut." So here Jesus is giving this illustration. He's giving this message that there were 10 girls. They went out, and you think of it like in modern day terms, they went out and they had their flashlight just in case. But 5 of them brought fresh batteries in their flashlight. The other 5 didn't check to see if there were batteries in their flashlight. And when it became dark, all of a sudden now the wedding party's becoming, they're coming through the town. And Jesus says they needed light to see. And the 5 ones who came unprepared missed out on the event, the blessing, or the promises, you and I can say, God's breakthrough in their lives, because they were unprepared. You see, God wants to move in your life. Can we just say it like that? Listen, God's desire is for you to not be the same today, tomorrow. He does not want you to plateau in your walk with Him. It's a continually progressing relationship that you grow in your love, you grow in your passion, you grow in your desire, you grow in your wisdom, you grow in the blessings of God each and every day in your relationship. And many times we're waiting, we're wanting, we're desiring. God, you spoke to me about this promise. God, I know that it was you that told me this. God, you said this about my children, or God, you said this about my job or about my finances. And we wait and we wait and we wait and we wait and we wait. And then all of a sudden the moment comes and we find ourselves unprepared to do what God has desired to do in our lives. We live in a consumer culture. You guys know what I'm talking about? We have things and we use them until they're exhausted and we throw them out. And we just continually consume and we consume and we consume and we consume. And at the advent of the ready-made, whatever it might be, the ready-made dinner, the ready-made store where you can go and you can buy whatever you want at one store instead of having to go all around town like you used to have to do, we've grown lazy in our lives and become unprepared in things, in the things of God, because that mentality has come over to our Christianity. I mean, let's talk about this. The American church, the Western church, so the rest of the world calls it, we come and we consume and we consume and we consume, but we do nothing on Monday through Saturday to prepare for what God wants to do in our lives. And when it comes time for God to move, we find ourselves like those 10 unwise virgins, unprepared. Listen, I'll be honest with you. I'm not here to condemn. I'm not here to put judgment. I'm not here to tell you this is what you ought to be doing. I've been there. If anything, I'll talk about myself. There have been times when God says, this is the moment that I want to move in your life, and I am totally unready for what God had because I did not do my part to prepare for what God wanted to do in my life. Can anybody give me an amen? I've been there. Hallelujah. So today I wanted to look back at this book of 2 Kings because it's really neat. In 2 Kings, the third chapter, in 2 Kings, the fourth chapter, and then again in 2 Kings, the fifth chapter, there's three miracles, there's three amazing things that God does to three separate groups of people. And every time we look through at the promises of God and God's intervention in somebody's life, we see that God says something and then there's a season of preparation. And I want to look at some principles here of preparing for God's promises. That's a lot of peace. Principles for preparing for promises. All right. I didn't even plan that. But today I want to look at some of these scriptures and just to see what God's word has to say that we can understand when it comes to God intervening, when it comes to God interjecting in our life, when it comes to God blessing, or when it comes to God outpouring, or when it comes to God speaking, or when it comes to God's promises at work in our lives. What does the Bible say about the preparation for God's promises? So I had you go with me to 2 Kings in the third chapter. Let's go there to 2 Kings in the third chapter. It's a couple of really cool stories. 2 Kings in the third chapter. Now, here in the third chapter, we see that there's a king and his name is Jehoshaphat. We see that there's another king, and Jehoram is the king of the son of Ahab, another king of Israel, and Jehoshaphat's the king of Judah. And here in this time, in this season, the leader, you could say the king of Moab, was a vassal servant. A vassal servant means that he owed money, he owed livestock, he owed service to the king of Israel. Well, when this new king took over, this king of Moab, or this leader of Moab, said, man, I'm tired of giving all my stuff to the king of Israel. I'm not going to do that anymore. So he begins to rebel against this king. And so this king of Israel comes to the new king of Judah, Jehoshaphat, and he says, listen, man, will you go with me to go fight the king of Moab? Because he's resisting me. He's coming against me. He's leading a rebellion against me. And Jehoshaphat says, yeah, man, you know, your men are my men. Your horses are my horses. Your land is my land. We're brothers. You know, of course, I'll go with you. And so they go. The Bible tells us to go into the wilderness area because they're going to try to flank this king from the south side of his land. So they go into the wilderness area, and the Bible begins to tell us here in 2 Kings in the third chapter that they marched for 7 days in this roundabout journey. And in a period of 7 days, they had no water. They had no water for themselves, for the soldiers. They had no water for their livestock, for their horses. And you know, scientists tell you that you can only go about 3 days without water until your body begins to shut down and you start to die after that process. And here they're in this area or this land or this wilderness of Edom. It's very desert. It's like Palm Desert. So imagine being in Palm Desert, hello, with no water for 7 days. Misery. And so they begin to say, man, you know, has God brought us out here that he might destroy us? And so Jehoshaphat says, you know, he doesn't know yet about this prophet named Elisha. And he says, is there not a man in the land, a prophet in the land that can tell us the word of God? And just so happens that Elisha, somebody tells him about him. So they summon Elisha, the prophet. And Elisha comes and he thoroughly rebukes the king of Israel. And he tells him, I wouldn't even be in the same room as you because your dad and your family, they all worshiped all the idols and you follow them just as much. Why are you even trying to talk to me? But he says, because of Jehoshaphat, I'll talk to you. And they say, man, we need to hear from God. And so there they inquire of him of God. And here we see, we'll pick up in the story now and looking at 2 Kings in the third chapter, beginning in verse number 16, and Elisha says to them after listening to some music and the harpist plays so that he might hear from God, he says, thus says the Lord, make this valley full of ditches. For thus says the Lord, you shall not see wind, nor shall you see rain yet in that valley, yet the valley shall be filled with water, so that you, your cattle, and all your animals may drink. So here he's telling them, God says that I'm going to bring water to you, but you need to dig some ditches. The thing that we need to understand is that God's promises will always precede our preparation. God's promises must always precede our preparation. God told them to dig ditches, so they dug ditches. But see, what happens is we want to be like the five unwise virgins or the five foolish virgins. And we want to look over here and say, well, that person had a promise from God. And God told that person to do thus. So therefore, if it works for them, I'll do what they're doing in expectation that God will do to me what God is doing to them. You guys, does that make sense? You with me? We look to somebody else and we say, I want what they're having. And so I'll do what they're doing in order to get from God what he promised to them. But you see, the promise of God will always precede the preparation, which means when God speaks to you, what God speaks to you, you need to do for you. Not what somebody else is doing, to not look to the left or to the right, but you need to hear from God. What God speaks to you is what you do. We can't try to manufacture. We can't try to conjure up or work hard to get God's promises to come through in our lives. We do that all the time. Can I get an amen? You know, I probably should say, can I get an oh man, right? We do this all the time. Well, if I just go to church this many times a week, if I just give this amount, if I just do this, if I can just do this, and all of a sudden we find ourselves wrapped up in this thing that gets us into trouble called religion. Because we're all about the preparation, but we're missing out on God's promise for us. So God tells these kings, y'all need to dig ditches. That's a little crazy. To dig ditches in a drought. But the promise always precedes their preparation. God was already working because this was not a miracle that happened over the course of months. The Bible says the next day, after the offering had been offered in the morning, the next day, flash floods came from a distant valley and filled the area up. You see, God was already working with the rains in another area. The water was already coming down. It was up to them to follow through with the preparation of God's promise. So we need to understand that God's promises will always precede. They'll always come before our preparation. If we try to put our preparation before God's promises, we find ourselves like Martha. Working, all mad that everybody else is getting in everything from God, and all we're doing is working and burning ourselves out. But when we understand that when God's promises come, they come before our preparation, and God gives us those directions. You know, I remember when Freedom for Our Future launched, my wife and I, we went before God and we said, God, we know this is of you. I mean, God had just dropped this whole thing in my heart. Man, we got to get out from underneath these financial institutions. You know, I mean, the bank was literally dangling interest rates over our head. Like, if you do this or if you do that, we're going to rate. And we just said, man, we cannot do this anymore. We cannot do this. And so God just lit it up on the inside of me, man, let's get going on this thing. And my wife and I, we talked. And I tell you what, it was like clear as day. God spoke to her what we ought to pledge. God spoke to me what we ought to pledge. We talked separately to God. We came together. It was the exact same number. We both looked at each other and said, it's a little crazy. It's a little out of the world. I mean, for us as young people, I mean, like, wow. But we knew that in doing so, we were going to be blessed. We know that in stretching out, we know that because of the promises of God, our yes and amen, we knew that when we would do that, God's promise preceded our preparation. So we stood on God's promises first, and then we did the preparations. And I'll tell you what, man, God has just gone over and above. And I don't want to get in front of myself or ahead of myself, but we had to. My wife started looking into different things. How can we do over and above what we make? Because we had to do that in order to make our pledge. So we started doing the puppy thing. I've told you guys about that. We sold some puppies, went to Freedom for Our Future. And then all of a sudden she did some other things and she was selling some products at Market Night, went to Freedom for Our Future. And then all of a sudden she got it. You notice that's all her? She got into real estate and God just began to bless that. And all of a sudden we look back and we're like, man, God, you have provided for us because your promise came before. And we looked to your promise, we listened to your word, and then we focused in on the preparation, the order of things to come. Don't look to somebody else's promise. Look to what God speaks to you. God gave them a very specific direction. Dig ditches in the wilderness in a drought because there's water coming today in a valley that you don't know of and it will flow to where you're at. They needed deliverance from the armies of Moab, and because of that water, they got that deliverance. Not only because it was sustenance to them, but also God used the sunlight on the water to deceive the army. They went in, they rushed in thinking they had it all made, and they got slaughtered because they went in with arrogance. Don't get wrapped up ahead of yourself by focusing on the preparations and missing out on the promises of God, the foundational works of our lives. So we're looking at that, and I love this. In the next chapter now, just turn the page to 2 Kings now in the fourth chapter, another great story. Another great story here in 2 Kings in the fourth chapter. I was just reading through this in my devotion. I thought, man, God, you are so good that you just, one after the next. And so here we see in 2 Kings, the fourth chapter, the story of the widow's oil. And here's a widow, and she has nothing left. She's prepared to die. She's got nothing going on. And Elisha gives her some directions. 2 Kings in the fourth chapter, he tells her in verse number 3, he says, then go and borrow vessels from all of your neighbors, everywhere, from all of your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. And then when you come in, you shall shut the door behind you, and you and your sons, and then you pour it into all of those vessels and set aside the full ones. He's talking about the little bit of oil that she had. She says, Elijah, I've only got this little tiny cup left of oil. That's all we have, and a little bit of flour. And he says, take that little tiny vessel of oil and get all these vessels, and I want you to start pouring it into these bowls, into these jars, behind closed doors. So she went from him and shut the door, and behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Look at verse number 6. Now it came to pass that when the vessels were full, she said to her son, bring me another vessel. So, and he said to her, there is not another vessel. So the oil ceased. Then she came and she told the man of God, and he said, go and sell the oil, pay off your debt, and you and your sons live on the rest. You see, the narrative of the story, the important part of the story is, you know, you think about it, the Bible tells us in the book of John that everything that Jesus himself did could not be contained in the libraries of the world. There's just too much. So I love it. We heard this a couple of weeks ago from Mike Keyes that everything that God put in the Bible is very succinct, very exact. It's not there by coincidence. There's a reason. And so in this narrative of the woman's oil, she says to her son, bring me another vessel. And he says, there's no more left. You see, things to understand about us is that God's promises will always exceed our expectations. God's promises will always exceed our expectations. You know, they say it like this, hindsight, it's 20/20. You know what I mean? You look back and, you know, right there, we know. We can tell by the narrative. You look back and you know what she's thinking to herself? I should have had more vessels. Why? Because we get into this mindset, well, God, if I can only just get this. God, if I could just get this little blessing. Lord, if I could just get a little bit over here. Lord, if you could just come through in this one area of my life, everything will be great. I'll be happy. I'm not asking for much. You know, we think if we ask God for little, that we'll actually get it, right? Anybody been there before? I'll be there. I'll admit, I've been there. God, I don't want to come with a big one, so I'll give you a little one. Maybe you can do that. But you see, the promises of God will always exceed our expectations. The oil didn't stop flowing until she ran out of jars. You cannot outlive, you cannot outgrow, you cannot outthink or outhope or outdesire God's provision, God's promises, God's desire for your life. You know, a couple of years ago, I wanted an iPad. Is that so bad? I just wanted an iPad. Some of you are like, I want one too. Amen. I wanted an iPad. I got one for my wife a long time ago, and we gave it to the church because they needed an iPad for something. So we said, the church can have it. And we didn't have an iPad. I thought, I want an iPad. I'm tired of carrying my computer around all the time. It was old, heavy, and hot. But we didn't do anything. It was dirt and freedom for our future. So we said, you know, we're not spending money on stuff that we don't need to buy. Like, I want an iPad, but I'm not going to buy an iPad. You know what's amazing? I did what I was supposed to do. We were faithful in our finances. We kept giving to the church like we said we were going to give. We didn't go over and above. Our goal was to pay off our debts and to get to give to freedom for our future. That was what God had spoken to us. So I said, you know, we're not going to do anything. You know what's amazing? I wanted an iPad. I went to God and said, God, I want an iPad. I got an iPad. I was given an iPad. That's cool, right? Man, it was an iPad mini. Okay. Remember I said God's promises exceed your expectations, so I got a small iPad. But then I went to a conference a couple of months later, and I was at this conference, and the pastor says, you know, I have a gift for all the pastors of the churches. I want you guys to go into this room. It's a surprise. I want you guys to go in this room and show them your name badge. So I go into the room and show them the name badge. Guess what? They gave me another iPad, which was really cool because Stacy wanted an iPad for Christmas, and I was like, cha-ching, don't gotta buy it. And then we were at our staff, our church, our employee staff dinner, and we had an extra iPad left over from our internship program. And everybody got raffle tickets when they came in the door. Guess what? I won the iPad. Three iPads in 1 year. I mean, I had more than I even knew what to do. I gave it back to church and said, somebody else get this because I don't need it. You see, God's promises will always go beyond your expectations. Don't dream small. When God speaks to you, his desires for you not just have a little corner of the promised land. He told Abraham, everything your eye sees is yours. So church, dream big when it comes to God's promises. Doesn't Ephesians 3:20 tell us that our God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think? So why are we dreaming small? We got to stand on the promises of God as our foundation. They precede our process or they precede our preparation. We don't get so wrapped up in work that we miss the promises of God. But then when it comes back to the promises of God, know that God's promise will always exceed your expectation. He'll go so far beyond what you could even think. All it takes is for you to trust in him. Which brings us to the last understanding of the promises of God and preparing there. And now we'll go to chapter 5. This is cool, just like chapter after chapter, miracle after miracle. I love it. Isn't the word of God just cool? Here in chapter 5, there's a man by the name of Naaman. Now, Naaman's an important man in the kingdom of Syria. So the king sends a letter to the king of Israel. The king of Syria sends a letter to the king of Israel. And he says, I am sending to you one of my generals, one of my leaders by the name of Naaman. Naaman has leprosy. I want you to heal him. Pressure. Right? Syria is a world force at the time. And so here the king gets this letter, rips his clothes. What am I, God, that I can create and that I can make things new? What am I supposed to do? So then all of a sudden somebody says, there's always that one servant somewhere, you know what I mean? That one servant says, well, king, there's Elisha. Have you heard about Elisha? He was the guy that, you know, he washed Elijah's hands. So the king says, oh man, send Naaman to Elisha. So there Naaman shows up this in all of his splendor and all of his glory and all of his pomp and circumstance with his chariot and his men and his servants. And he shows up to Elisha's house, rolls up deep like that. You know what I mean? Goes to Elisha's house. And now we'll pick up in verse number 10. Look what he says in verse number 10 of chapter 5. And Elisha sent a messenger to him. All right, all right. I came all the way from the north to you, to your little podunk country town, right? And you don't even answer your own door? You're going to send a servant to talk to me? He's offended. So Elisha sends a messenger to him saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh will be restored to you, and you shall be clean. Okay, pretty simple, pretty clear, pretty direct, right? Wouldn't you say? There's no really questions about, okay, wait, the Jordan. Now you're talking about, just go wash in the river. Take a bath 7 times. No big deal. Naaman became furious and went away and said, indeed, I said to myself, listen to this, because this is you. This is me. Come on, we've all been there. Indeed, I said to myself, he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand all over the place and heal the leprosy. That is Christians 101. God, I need you to be healed, and I'm going to come to the church, and the pastor, he's going to be spitting all over the place. He's going to be sweating and dripping. He's got his rag, and people can be running from east to west because the Holy Spirit's all over them, and it's going to be crazy. He's going to come over, and he's going to point me out of the crowd. He's going to call me up here. He's going to lay hands on me, and the crowd's going to go wild, and my sickness is going to go away. And then you go to church, and nothing happens, and you say, God, where were you? Right? That's what exactly what Naaman was doing. Man, Elisha's going to come out. He's going to wave his hands all over me, and God's going to shake the skies, and boom, I'm going to be healed. And Elisha said, go take a bath. Are you kidding me?
I'd probably be mad too. And so he says to himself, are not the Abana and the Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all of the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. Sometimes some of y'all have left church in a rage before. All right. And his servants came near and spoke. There's always that one servant. You notice that in all these messages, there's always that one servant. His servants came near and spoke to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says, wash and be clean? So he went down and he dipped 7 times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. You see, we talked about this, that God's promise will always precede our preparation. That God's promises will exceed our expectations. Now we get to look to the preparation of preparing for God's promise. Preparation always works in faith. The preparation of God's promises always works in faith. One of my friends said it like this. I thought it was a brilliant statement. He's not here, so I won't even mention his name and give him credit. It was my statement now. God's directions may not make sense, but they're always clear. Let me say that again, because I said it. God's directions may not make sense, but they're always clear. I mean, think about it. God says to the man, tells the man of God tells Elisha, go tell him to take a bath 7 times. That doesn't make any sense. But it was clear. Go to the Jordan, go in, get out, dry off. Then go in, get out and dry off. And then go back in. Get out and drive 7 times. Just do it. See, the preparation always works in faith. To step out. Think about when God spoke to Abraham. God said to Abraham, give him clear directions. He said, go to a land I will show you. And you will be a blessing. God spoke to, I was thinking about just the message of Saul. When Saul was knocked off his horse on the road to Tarsus, it becomes Paul. God speaks to a man in Ananias. He says, man, I want you to take Saul into your house and lay hands on him. And Ananias says, God, isn't this the guy? I've heard of this guy.
He's the one that's like locking people up and killing them. You want me to go find him and bring him to my house? Didn't make any sense, but the direction was clear. See, the preparation of God's promises always works in faith. It may not make sense to you. It may not seem logical, like digging ditches in a desert, in a drought, like going and getting a bunch of empty Tupperware dishes, or taking a bath 7 times in a muddy river. But they're always clear, and it always results in working in faith. So we've got to learn. See, God's desire for us, he wants to intervene. He wants to move in your life. He wants to bless you, church. He does not want you to be broke down, to be busted up, to be wrecked all throughout your life. God says, I've got a desire. I've got a plan. I've got promises. I've got a purpose. I've got blessings. But you need to be like the 5 wise virgins in Matthew, the 10th or 25th chapter, that you are prepared so that when it's time for the promises of God to manifest themselves in your life, you are open and ready and prepared to handle it. Because otherwise, you'll be caught off guard and stay where you're at. So we have an understanding. We know that, you know, we got to learn. We got to rest on God's promises because they come before our preparation. We understand that God's promises, man, we got to dream big because they'll always exceed our expectations. We have to understand that our preparation is always a work of faith. It will never make sense logically, but that's because God wants us to lean on him. Now we have an understanding. What does that mean for us? Because now we understand it. That's great, but it doesn't do anything for us until we do something with it. And here it is, so easy for you. Get prepared for God's promises. That's it. It's that easy. That's the application for the message. Pastor Luke, how do I do that? He told you. Pastor Luke, I need the how-to. He told you. Let that sink in for a moment. He told you. If he gave you a promise, remember point number one, his promises precede the preparation. God already told you what to do. You just haven't been doing it. Jesus, he nailed it on the head when he was 12 years old. 12 years old. His parents are looking for him. I mean, you think if you've ever thought you felt bad because maybe you lost a kid, I lost my kid at Disneyland. I've talked about that before. Joseph and Mary lost Jesus for 3 days. What? Dust yourself off. It's all right, you know. They find Jesus in the temple. Jesus says, why are you worried? Didn't you know that I would be about my father's business? He says, man, I got things coming my way, and I got to get prepared now while I'm 12 to do what God wants me to do when I'm 30. Get to doing what God told you to do. That's the application. It's that simple. You see, the problem today is that there are too many Christians who sit on the couch. Uh-oh, I'm a metal for a minute. There are too many couch Christians that sit back and they say, well, I don't have to do anything because God's already promised it. All I gotta do is sit back and take it easy and wait for God to deliver on his promise. But I'll tell you something, from Genesis to Revelation, God gives his disciples, his followers, his people promises, and they're always followed by preparation. So where do we get thinking that I can sit on the couch and do nothing with my life and expect to God to come and do everything he needs to do because I've given him no effort? What business owner, think about this, what business owner would go on a vacation for 365 days out of the year and never contact their business, never think about their business, never go back to their business, never call and check up how they're doing, and just stay out on vacation and expect their business to grow and succeed? Nobody would do that. It would never succeed. Even Bill Gates, who's retired, is still involved in Microsoft. But yet we think all we got to do is sit back. The grace of God is going to come and it's going to pour over me and it's going to do everything. I don't need to do anything. But I ask you, where do you find that in the Bible? Because Jesus nailed it on the head. I must be about my Father's business. So you're sitting there, you're waiting, saying, God, why haven't I gotten that promotion at my job? God, why? You said I'm going to have a financial breakthrough. God, why haven't I gotten that financial breakthrough? God, why is everything that I put my hand to not blessed but seemingly cursed? God, why is it that I seem the same today as I was last year? Why is it this and why is it that and why? And then we find ourselves like Naaman, mad. Well, the preacher must have missed the message. It was the preacher's fault. He didn't tell me what I needed to do tonight. It was the music. I can't connect to the music anymore. I didn't feel the presence of God anymore. Well, that must be that church. It must be the city. It must be this and this and this. And it's everything but us. But the truth of the matter is, church, until we get up off the couch and do something about the promises of God, God is going to sit there and wait for us to do it. Ah! Listen, as a pastor, we get it all the time. People come up, Pastor Luke, man, I just need you to pray for me. My life is a wreck and I need God to intervene on fill in the blank, whatever it is. My job, my mom, my family, my kid, whatever. God, I just need God. Okay, let's pray together. Give them some scriptures. All right, here's what we're going to do. This is what you need to believe. This is what the Word of God is saying, telling you to do. Get connected. Get into church. Get your life straight. If you need to get your life right with God, get your life right with God. Okay, let's pray. Next year comes by. Same clothes, same everything, same look on their face. They catch you a year later. And you're like, you can tell by the look on their face. Pastor Luke, I just need you to pray for me. I just need God to intervene on fill in the blank that you filled in last year. All right, well, did you do? No, I haven't done that yet. Well, but Pastor Luke, I just need you to tell, what does the Bible say? I told you last year what the Bible said. There's not a new book today. Like, it's insane. 2 years later, they come back. 3 years later, they come back. Pastor Luke, I just need you to pray for me. My life was a mess. I need God to intervene on fill in the blank what I filled in 3 years ago. Oh, God must not be listening. And then I ask them, well, what have you been doing? Did you do what we talked about? No. Have you been coming to church? You know, you heard this one. I try. You can't even come to church on a consistent basis to show enough reverence and respect to the God you're expecting to do something in your life that you can't even attend church on a regular basis, and then yet you expect God to drop everything around the world and do what you need to get done when you don't give him it. Can I just tell you like it is? The application today is get up off your butt and do what God told you to do. You'll get his promises. It's that easy. Which means, for those of you that asked me last year to pray for you, you best not come to me, go to Pastor Dan, because I'm going to lecture you. Listen, the Bible tells us in the book of 1 Corinthians that God is not a God. He doesn't sow confusion. He's a God of, not the author of confusion, but of peace. God's desire is for you to not wander around aimlessly. What do I do? He told you what to do. Why is nothing happening? Go back to the very beginning if you have to. What did he tell you to do a year ago? 5 years ago? Listen, some of you, what did he tell you to do 45 years ago? Go back to what he told you to do. Start doing what he told you to do. And guess what? God will come through. There's a common denominator in all of these stories that we looked at today. Digging ditches in the desert during a drought. Man, that is cool, right? Ditches in a desert during a drought. Digging ditches in the desert during a drought. Getting empty jars. I mean, think about that. Think about that. All the people of Israel are like, all right. They told us to go dig ditches. They're out there. Why are we digging, man? I don't know. You know why we're digging? No, I don't know why we're digging, man. Think about the widow. Can I borrow your empty Tupperware? You're starving. I know. Can I borrow any empty jars that you have? You don't even have food. I've seen you. You look like you haven't eaten in 15 days. I know. Can I borrow whatever you got? Oh, she's looking weird. Look at Naaman. Imagine that. Standing at the River Jordan. Is anybody looking? All right, here we go. All right. There we go again. Is anybody coming? All right, here we go. 7 times, back and forth, back. The common denominator is they were all doing something. Abraham got up and left the land of his fathers. And God gave him the promised land. The apostles did what Jesus told them to do. They changed the world. The men of God all throughout the Bible, from Genesis all the way through Revelation, the common denominators, God spoke to them and they did something. But yet somehow, for some reason, we find ourselves today saying, God, that's your promise and I'm not going to do anything about it because it's your promise. When the burden of responsibility falls on us to prepare for God's promise, and when we prepare, I'll tell you what, his promises always precede our preparations. When we prepare, his promises will so far exceed our expectations. And our process or our preparations are always going to work in faith. They may not make sense, but they're always clear. Because God's not desire, his desire is not for you to be confused. He spoke to you. If he gave you a promise, he told you what to do. Pastor Luke, I need you to tell me what God, if he spoke to you a promise, he gave you what to do. You just need to go back. Get with God. God, forgive me, I wasn't listening. What do I need to do? Start doing what you need to do. Imagine, just imagine for a moment, if every person in America, if every person in church came into these doors the way we do, broken, and we left blessed. Imagine what that would look like to the people outside of this building that have no concept of Jesus. But instead, what happens is we say, well, God's got a promise for me, and they watch you. Year later, you're in the same position. God's got a promise for you. You're still trying to get over that vice. God's got a promise. 2 years later, God, man, your God's kind of slow. 3 years later, man, your God, I don't know, like Elijah starts, and is he sleeping? I don't know. Imagine if every time we came into this place broken and we did what God told us to do, in preparation for his promises, we would walk out of this place blessed. What that would look like to the world outside. The effectiveness of the church, so that when Jesus says that we're a light on a hill that is not easily hidden, that we are the salt of the earth, now all of a sudden we live his words, because people will say, man, you were like, I don't know how you survived. You were like that widow. You were so far into debt they were going to take your sons as slaves, but all of a sudden something happened. Man, I don't know. You started giving money to that church and everybody told you were crazy, but now all of a sudden you're out of debt. You got a new home and whatever it might be. People are going to start saying, what are you doing? All you got to say is, I'm preparing. Didn't you know I'd be about my master's work? Preparing for God's promises. Nowhere does it give us the right to sit back and do nothing and wait for God to do everything. God says, I gave you the promise. I gave you the instruction. Now it's time for you to get on your feet and do something about it. And when you do, boom, I will knock your socks off. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Wouldn't you give him a great big praise? Listen, before we leave, I want to just take a quick moment. I won't take much more of your time, but, you know, I don't know everybody in this building. It would be really neat if we all knew each other intimately, but I don't know you. And it would be devastating for us to leave this place today under the pretense that everybody is right and great and in the perfect position with God, when in reality there are those of you in this place that aren't. So I want you to answer a question that I'm going to ask you in your heart, in your mind. You see, nobody's going to know the answer except you and God. The Bible tells us that a man needs to examine himself from time to time. It's time for some inner reflection. So I want you to be open. I want you to be honest with this question. The question is if you were to die today, would you find yourself in heaven or would you find yourself in hell? Listen, we're all one virus. We're all one accident. We're all one epidemic or incident away from our eternal destiny. We don't know the hour. We don't know the time. We don't know how. And most people, when polled, say they don't even want to know. To think, to assume that you've got more time or that everything's okay when they're really not, listen, you put yourself in a precarious and a dangerous place, and it would be a shame for you to leave this place under that pretense without hearing the truth. So today I want to talk to you, say, yeah, I don't know about that heaven or hell. I don't know about eternal existence. I just haven't quite landed. The jury's still out. Listen, let me tell you something. Just because you haven't seen it, because you haven't felt it, because you haven't experienced it for yourself, doesn't mean it's not real. Listen, there are things in this world we know for a fact that exist that we cannot see. I'll give you one example right now. There are radio waves going from me right now to the sound booth, but you can't see them, you can't feel them, but you can experience them because you hear the sound of my voice. You see, burying your head about your eternal existence in the sand will never make it go away. Heaven's a real place, real enough for God to speak about it, real enough for Jesus to teach us about it, real enough for the Bible to be preserved over thousands of years so that we would have the opportunity to evaluate and to examine our position with God. And today, I want to talk to you about that. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope, that you can think, that you can want, that you can wish. Man, I have the most positive outlook on life. So often when I talk to people, they say, man, I hope I'm going to go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you have enough hope that you're going to get to heaven? That if you have a desire to go to heaven, man, I want to go. Well, God says, well, if they want to, I'll let them. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope your way into heaven. You can think your way into heaven. Listen, nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can get yourself in heaven because of ritual traditions. Well, I go to church. I hear the pastor preach. I was baptized as a child. I was christened as a baby. I went to Sunday school classes. I even have a card in my wallet that says I'm a member. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend ritual ceremonies, because you sit in the church and you hear the pastor preach, because you've got a card in your wallet, nowhere in the Word of God does it say that that's going to get you into heaven? Man, in America, we like to give ourselves titles. Everybody around us does it now. Well, I'm this or I'm that, or this is what I am or I associate with. So we like to say, well, I'm a Christian. So because I give myself the title of Christian, that means I'm going to go to heaven. Christians go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you labeled yourself a Christian that you're going to get to heaven? I mean, in reality, that's like sitting in your garage, giving yourself the label of a car, expecting to be a car. You'll never be a car. Yet we think all we need to do is call ourselves to fill out on the U.S. census that I'm a Christian, and that means that I'm going to get to heaven. But nowhere in the Word of God does it say that that's going to get you to heaven. You can't get to heaven because you're a good person. Man, we think that all the time. Well, if I do good deeds, if I stand for social justice or I live for a cause, I give to charitable organizations, I do the best I can to help out my fellow human being, I stand up when I see somebody getting bullied or picked on. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, that means you're going to get to heaven? The Bible does tell us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you and I could ever do would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because God's standard to get into heaven is perfection. But the Bible does say this about you and I. It says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means that we have all slipped up. We've all messed up. We've all come short of the mark. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. Listen, you don't get to heaven because of a system of classification. Well, I wasn't a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim. I always thought that that meant that I was a Christian and going to go to heaven. You can't work for it. The only way you and I can get to God's heaven is God's way, and that's through Jesus Christ. Jesus says these words. He says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through him. So today I want to give you the opportunity, God's way, to get into God's heaven. In John, the third chapter, you can read it later for yourself if you'd like. Jesus is having a discussion with a man by the name of Nicodemus. A religious leader, a man who did all the right things, said all the right things, memorized scripture, played the part. Jesus says these words, that in order to see the kingdom of God, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, you must be born again. What does that mean to be born again? Well, it's not what you're thinking. It's not what Hollywood and the society and the internet's made born again out to be, that crazy, weirdo, out of control Christianity. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has always, listen, it's always meant the same thing in the heart of God. It means that you've given your heart, you've given your life. It's an all or nothing relationship. All of your heart, all of your life. Let me prove it to you. In the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus himself is speaking to the church. It's his final plea to the church, to you and I. His final beckoning call. And he says, man, you guys think you're rich. You think that you're wealthy. You think that you've got it all together. But he says, you don't realize how naked and how destitute you are. He says, oh, that I wish you would come to me. He says, I'm going to come and I'm going to find you one day. I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He goes on, he says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement from Jesus' mouth. And he's pleading with the church, stop thinking that you can do it your way, because you can't get to heaven your way. You can't get to heaven my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. The only way we can get to heaven is God's way through Jesus Christ. And today, I want to give you that opportunity. What does it mean to be lukewarm when he says, I'd rather find you hot or cold? What is lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. Occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. You can even say it like this. You've been sitting on the couch in your Christianity, not doing a dang thing about it, expecting God to make up for all your deficiencies. Jesus says, man, when I come back, I better not find you in that position. It's a bad place to be. And I love you enough. I respect you enough. Today, I'll tell you the truth. I got a little hard on you at the end. Got a little fired up. And I'll tell you the truth. You're not going to make it to heaven based on your own wishes, your own desires. Not going to get to heaven based on a set of rules and regulations that we call religion. You can't get to heaven because you've given yourself a title. The only way you can get there is by accepting the gift of salvation, the Bible says, of Jesus Christ. It's the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. And like any gift, You have the choice to accept it or to reject it. Your call. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way, and he won't kick down your doors of your life. He's a gentleman. He's done everything he could by giving for you, Jesus, to die a beaten, bloody mess on a cross for our sins, yours and mine, that we would accept the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. So today I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you. He says, but if you deny him, he'll deny you. So today, in just a moment, I'm going to do something. I'm going to do this. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and then on the count of three, I'm going to go three. I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. I'm going to ask you to do something bold right when I smack my hands. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to do something real bold. I want you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Oh, I'm going to be embarrassed if I raise my hand. I won't embarrass you. I promise you, I won't embarrass you. But even if you were embarrassed, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment here in church than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm and welcome and loving place? The decision is yours today. What you're doing is you're making the decision. It's your choice to make. So today, all across this auditorium, from the front to the back, from the side to side, even if you're at home watching on the live stream, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place, in just a moment, I'm going to give you that opportunity. When I count to three, I want you to pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge you and put it right back down. Who should raise their hands? If you've never given Jesus your heart, you've never given him your life, if that's you, in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child, or you prayed that prayer once long ago on TV, or you went to a Harvest Crusade, but you've never really followed up with it or never really followed through, listen, don't walk out of this place today without making sure. Today is the day of your salvation. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing, running from God instead of to God, hey, don't walk out of this place today without making sure. You've had doctors, dentists, and DMV appointments. Today, it's a divine appointment between you and God. Don't let anything stop you or talk you out of making the decision today. But it's your choice to make and yours alone. He respected you. God respected you enough to give you a free will choice. Today, I believe that the Spirit of God is speaking to you, and it's time for you to make that decision. I'm going to count to three in just a moment, and as I do, if that's you, whether you're in the family rooms, in the front row, the back row, listen, if you've been in this church for 26 years or 1 hour, I don't care. If I'm speaking to you today, that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back, and I'm going to go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five. All right, I got you guys over there. Five wise people, six back there, seven. I got you, eight back there. Eight wise people, two in the family room, yeah? Two? Okay, I got you guys back in the family room. Eight wise people. Anybody else in this place today? I got you guys, eight, nine. I got you right there, 10. Cool. 10 wise people. You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. This is your moment. Spirit of God speaking to you. Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. If you're feeling that tug, don't deny it. It's your time. 10 wise people. Anybody else in this place today say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Come on. Anybody else today? I'm going to close it up. Well, praise God for 10 wise people. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, here's what we're going to do. All 10 of you, a bunch of guys over here, some of you guys over here, even in the family room, you guys over here in the back, if you raise your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, say, man, I should have done that. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You're making a decision. Remember I said that? Every decision requires action. We're going to do that together. We're going to follow through together. So if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, or friend if you need a friend. If you got your family or somebody's with you, say, hey, come on, come with me. Or if somebody next to you raised their hand, say, come on, I'll go with you. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle. The ushers will help you grab your stuff in the family rooms. Come and get into the aisles and come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, come meet me up here, right now. Let's change destinies together.
Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
Oh, I got you.
Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong.
That's you. You come. Come on.
To you. You're the reason that I live.
They're still coming. We'll wait for you. If you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, you need to get out of your chair. Get up here. This is your moment.
Jesus, I believe.
Praise God. They're still coming. We'll wait for you. We'll give you guys a minute to get down here. It's cool. Thank you. That's awesome, the whole family. Hey guys, listen. First of all, congratulations, great job. You're not going to the morgue, all right? Going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. You can smile, good job, all right? I want to do a couple things with you. First, I'm going to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel, waving at you. Pastor Joel. I kind of slurred that together. Really cool guy. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I am as weird as it gets. Totally, you made it through me, okay? He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to do a couple things. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You're making a decision. You're going to follow through with action by inviting Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Okay, so you're going to invite him into your life, and he's going to lead you in a prayer to do that. Second thing he's going to do is he wants to give you just some free information. You get saved, you raise your hand and say, okay, I'm making that commitment. What do I do next? We want to help point you in the right direction on the race that you're running. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want you to come back and hang out with us, all right? You heard the word of God. You're here today. That's why you're here. You heard the word of God. We want you to come back and hang out with us. We want to connect you with a friend here at the church, meet with you for a couple of weeks to buy a cup of coffee or sit with you, get you a soda or some french fries in our cafe on a Sunday morning if you come on a Sunday morning. Just to teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big long program. Just a friend that will sit with you for a couple of weeks to get you strong in the ways of God so you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel, all right?
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.